Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are from eternity. You created the heavens and the earth, all that we know, Lord, that exists, stuff we don't even know about. And we thank you, Lord, for that. And you love even us. And God, you desire to be with us, to dwell with us, and we thank you for that. So God, we just welcome you to this place right now. We welcome you in worship, and we welcome your Holy Spirit, the author of these words, to help us to understand better. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'd like to follow along in your Bibles today, you know where we're at. We're going to be in John chapter 14, the first seven verses, a few other places as well, but that's where we're going to kind of camp out. And if you want to follow along in the outline, that's cool. If you are watching online, if you can go to the YouVersion app, it's a Bible app on any of your app stores. And just if you download that, you click on St. John Events, and you can do that at home or in person here, and that will take you to the full outline with all of the answers already there. So that's super cool for you. So we're talking about more, and we've been in this for about the last few weeks, talking about God has so much more for us in our life that we don't realize until we stop, pause, and listen to what he tells us and encourages us about life in his word. Today, we're going to talk about even more after this life. It's called heaven, the more that is to come. And if you're like me, you've had a birthday recently, and I'm starting to think I'm at that age where I have more birthdays behind me than are in front of me. I'm kind of right on that edge there. So some of you, if you've only had a few birthdays, you're thinking like, I don't think about heaven that much at all. I'm gonna live a long time. In fact, how medicine is happening and stuff, I might live about 200 years, you think. Right, I'm not thinking that. I don't know if I want to live that long, especially. Anyway. If you're older than me, you probably think often, you know, I wonder what heaven is like. And you might have that question that really comes up often. What happens when I die? That's the first one on your list here. What happens when I die? And the world has all sorts of answers for you. All sorts of answers that most of them, unless they're biblical, they're not true. And the world sometimes has no answers for you in what happens if I die. And if you want to look in the Bible, well, there's a lot about that in there. In fact, we'll just go to one famous section that we use sometimes at funerals, celebrations of life. It's from an early missionary named Paul. He wrote a letter to the church in Thessalonica. It's called 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And here's what he says in verse 14, some words of encouragement. He says this, "For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him." So Paul tells us there's going to be something after the grave. God has a huge plan for you after the grave, and you're going to be with Jesus. Now, this is super important because when you think of being with Jesus, with God the Father, when you actually look in the Old Testament, the Hebrew, the New Testament, the Greek, the verbiage that is used, the words for heaven in the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, guess what it means? They simply mean where God dwells, God's dwelling place. That is heaven. So if we are going to be with Jesus, with the Lord, that's heaven. That's heaven. So keep that in mind as we go through this today. Some of you, if you think, okay, if I try to close my eyes and picture heaven, what do I picture? This more that is to come. I would bet that most of you picture from our friends in the Renaissance era, 400, 500 years ago, those pictures of heaven. So I have a couple of them just to kind of see if that's what you're thinking, okay? And it was so hard to find people that weren't chubby and naked to show in church. I'm like, oh, I can't show that one. When I'm searching for these online, I want someone in my office to make sure I'm searching the right thing, right? So this is like a picture of heaven right here. This has all three of them. You got heaven up top, earth there, and then people down there, they're all naked and they're far enough away. Did anybody bring their telescope to church? Okay, praise God, I'm not in trouble. And if you're online, don't like zoom in. Anyway. This is what their rendition is. I'm not too excited about it. Here's another one that if you look up in the ceiling, then there's like clouds. People are chubby still and half naked. Some of them are wearing robes. They're have harps. And I got to tell you that when I started going through confirmation, when I became a Lutheran 6th, 7th grade, and we were talking about this heaven stuff, and they had sermons on it, and they were saying, you're going to be, you know, like this. I thought, I'm going to wear a robe and play a harp and sing these hymns that I'm not too into right now. I'd rather stay here on earth for a while. And some of you may be there. right? But there's some more modern pictures, if you will, of heaven. I want to set this one up for you because it'll give you maybe a different understanding. On February 12th of 2000, two very important, prestigious people in this country went to heaven. They died on the same day, February 12th, 2000. The first one was Charles Schulz. And if you don't know who Charles Schulz was, he was the creator of Peanuts. If you don't know what Peanuts is or was, well, I can't help you, okay? Now I can. So Peanuts is basically the name of the cartoon series and stuff that has, in the comic series, that has Charlie Brown. You know, Charlie Brown Christmas and Lucy. And anyways, so lots of times Charlie Brown is getting ready to kick a football. Lucy's holding it and she moves it. He kicks and he falls. You know, that's it. Anyway, the creator of that series, Charles Schulz, went to heaven on that day. On the same day, guess who else went to heaven? Their last breath on this earth. It was one of our greatest Texas coaches, football player, you name it, Tom Landry. Yeah, if you don't know Tom Landry and you're young here, man, he was a football in this state. In fact, he was so big in football, we have highways next to Six Flags in Arlington named after Tom Landry. Okay, he's a big guy. So he's a football guy. So the version of heaven that next day that someone drew was super cool. Look, it's right here. And it basically has Landry there and Schulz, and it says, now a few pointers on kicking a football. Now that's romantic and exciting. For me, that's more exciting than robes and half-naked people with harps. But it's still, I don't think that's heaven, right? That probably is not happening. I'm hoping besides football, like in baseball, maybe the Rangers won't just be a triple-A team for the Yankees, right? Hopefully the Rangers will be good in heaven. Well, who knows? Well, guess what? We don't have to rely on these pictures. Jesus actually gives us a great vision of what's that like. In fact, you probably are feeling this most when you think of this. You say, is there more to this life race I'm in right now? Is there more to this? I can have some laughs, I can look at pictures, but my life is so crazy, I'm so busy, and I lay my head down and I wish, maybe you're like me, I wish I had done something that day that was meaningful and exciting, but you're like, man, I just did laundry, dishes, I move people around here from there, I'm a professional doctor visitor, I go to doctors, that's all I do, you know, like, but you know what? There is more to this life race, and God is doing this stuff slowly along the way to get you ready for heaven. And so what are you ready for? What is that more? Jesus tells us, look at this. Jesus has a description of heaven. It's the more that is to come. So here we go. Strap on. We got so much we could talk about. We only have a few minutes, but listen and take notes and get ready. So the first thing Jesus tells us about heaven, he describes it, and in his description, as he's getting ready to say, if you want to see what it's like, I first of all got to tell you, there is trouble and trust. Trouble and trust when we start talking about heaven. You're like, what is that? I hope there's no trouble in heaven. But look where he starts. Look where he starts with his disciples. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, you trust, but you believe in God, believe also in me. So here's what he's saying. Jesus is saying, you know, I can see you're troubled, but don't let your hearts be troubled because I have a plan. I have something more. Believe, trust me in this. Now, why in the world would he at this moment talk about them being troubled? I mean, he's talking about heaven. He actually was in the midst of having the Last Supper with them. I mean, they were having the Passover meal. He was instituting communion. He was making this meal we're going to have here, this amazing meal in a second we're going to have. It was like going on. So you're thinking, well, this is feast time. This is great. Why were they troubled? Well, if you look back in the context, remember, context is king. You understand the context of Scripture, you'll understand what it's saying. If you look back just a little bit, on their way to this upper room, on their way to have the meal, the disciples are arguing about what? Who is the greatest going to be in heaven? When you come, they're thinking about heaven. They got heaven on their mind going to this meal. They're like, man, we get there, I'm going to sit at the right. Hey, mama, can you go ask him if I'm going to sit at the right hand? All this. And Jesus, look at what he does. When he gets there, he immediately sits down. He takes his outer garment off. He puts a towel around his waist and he starts to do the lowliest of low, most humiliating, humble things for them, washes their feet. Now, if I were one of those who were thinking like, okay, who's the greatest? And that happens, I would feel pretty sheepish. I would think, oh my goodness, man, I'm trying to impress this guy. I've been following him for 3 years. I want him to think good of me. And then look what happened again. Like, I'm thinking all about me and he's thinking all about us. And so you could have a troubled heart, but it gets worse because they're getting ready to have the meal. And then there's this Judas guy, and he's this guy who's one of the 12. And they're looking at him and they know that he carries the purse, the money all the time for the last 3 years of ministry. And scripture tells us, you know, on the side that he kind of dips into there now. I mean, like his girlfriend probably was wearing Uggs, new Uggs every month. I mean, new stuff all the time. And they're probably thinking, where'd he get that? You know where he got it. And then Jesus goes further. He says, you know, the one who dipped the bread in, gonna give it to him. This guy right here, this is the one that's gonna betray me. And he says, just go and do what you were born to do. And then Jesus continues on. He's like, hey, by the way, I've been telling you I'm going to be, he's going to betray me. I'm going to be crucified. I'm going. I'm going to leave you. If you were there right then, your heart would be troubled. I had given up 3 years to follow this guy. And I know my parents might not have been super excited about it. I know my sister wasn't, you name it. And the church leaders, we used to go to synagogue and they're like, you're nuts. And now Jesus, you're saying you're leaving? Let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in me. And so Jesus has more to say. This is where he goes next. He says, heaven is real. Heaven is real. Listen to what he says. In my Father's house, he has many rooms. And if that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back to take you with me, that you will also be where I am, and you know the way to the place I am going. So, he says there are rooms. Do you know back then, not everybody had a room, let alone a house? I mean, most of the houses just had a couple rooms. If you look in Bethlehem where Jesus was born, you got like the main room, a guest room, and then a room for all the animals. Everybody's doing everything right there, and that's a nice house. Some people lived in tents still. They lived outside of town, you name it. And Jesus says, hey, for you, and he's saying for you, you believe in me, you trust me, I have a room for you. So what he's saying is heaven is permanent. It's not just a tent you pick up and go. It's not just this pie in the sky. There is actually a permanent, there's a room that God is preparing for you. I wonder what your room looks like. You ever wonder what room he has for you, what preparations he's making, what color it is, what scenery, do you have an espresso machine? You know, what all do you have in there? Who's your room gonna be by? Or certain people you're like, I don't know. And you think about this, you feel lots of love when you think about he is intentionally preparing something for you. If you have relatives coming, and you will because the holidays are coming, if you want to pour out love to them, you will actually change the sheets on the guest bed. If you want them to leave early and you don't like them, then don't change them. You go in the bathroom, and if you're going to prepare a room for them, you're going to change the towels, or else you're going to leave the ones with the nasty brown and the makeup stains and all that stuff on there. I mean, it plays out like this. But Jesus is saying, I not only have a real place for you, but I'm going to prepare this for you. That's how much I care for you, right? This is a real place. This is heaven. And just a little side note, I don't have it printed for you, but I have it up on the screen. So I love this about Thomas. Look what Thomas does. He says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. What are you talking about here? So how do we know the way? And Jesus gave this brilliant and beautiful statement. He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. You know, you only come to the Father except through me. You know what I love about Thomas there? He was honest. Jesus is talking about heaven, and he was honest. I don't get it. Think about it. You were told about heaven up in the sky, hell's down here, and then you take your first plane trip, you get above the clouds, you're like, where is it? I don't see it. And then you don't tell anybody, but you're thinking, you're like, I was told heaven is up here, and I don't see it. And you might have just talked to your friend William Shatner this week too, and he probably didn't see these naked people up there in harps and all this kind of stuff. Where's heaven? Well, this is where we trust God. He's so big and so greater than us. We know there's a heaven. It is beyond our understanding and imagination, even dimension probably, right? Heaven is heaven. But we do know this. Heaven is where, what did I tell you before? What does scripture tell you? Where God dwells. And so your heaven is real. It's a real place, and it's where God dwells. And that's where you're going to be. So we continue on. Heaven is full of love and bliss. Love and bliss. Remember, is you're loved in heaven because Jesus is preparing something lovingly for you. But look, Jesus continues on in another part of the Bible. This is to one of his followers who was there at this conversation. His name is John now. This is years later. John's on an island. He's in trouble for his faith. And Jesus comes to him and gives a revelation. And so the book was called, this is real creative, Revelations, right? So, yeah. Revelation 21. Okay, this is what John is seeing. This is what Jesus is revealing to him. Jesus is revealing this to him. He says, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God is, and here it comes again, my friends, God's dwelling place now is amongst his people, and he will dwell with them. This is heavenly. They will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will be their God. And oh, here it gets good. It gets better. Here's the description of heaven. He's going to wipe away every tear. Thank you, Jesus. There will be no more death. Thank you, Jesus. Or mourning or crying or pain. Thank you, Jesus. For the old order of things has passed away. That's where we get this. We get this idea that when you hit the grave, God has so much more in store for you. That's just the beginning. As one of my friends says, when you take your last breath here, you take your first breath in heaven. It's beautiful. It's going to be beautiful. So the question you're probably thinking right now is, how can I experience this now? How can I experience this now? You might have heard the phrase, people say, well, they're so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. But they're all talking about heaven. I can't wait. Well, what about, we're still here. God has a purpose for us here. If you're breathing, you're alive, you're here. God has it. So how can I experience heaven here? There's three ways you can do this. First of all, read about it. Don't watch videos on this stuff that they think is heaven's like. I mean, you can look at the video, but don't start there. Look and read about it. Because all over Old and New Testament, there are visions, descriptions, as I just shared a few of them with you, of this is what heaven is like. God does not hide this from us. It's beautiful. The second thing is this, dream about it. And you know, you can dream in the daytime. You don't have to be asleep. You can get your favorite beverage, sit there, turn the TV off, turn your phones off, you name it, and just say, okay, Lord, I want to dream about what my room is going to be like. What is heaven like? Who is there? Which one of my loved ones are already there? You know, the Bible says my loved ones are resting with you. We don't know exactly what all that means, but we do know that they are, again, with Jesus, and that's the dwelling. That's heaven. They're heavenly. They're with Jesus, right? So what's that look like? And you know what? If you look at the Bible closely, God spoke to a lot of people, gave them a lot of visions in dreams. So if you happen to dream about heaven, come let me know. I got to hear about this. Let's just see how that coincides with the Bible. Why dream about it? Let your mind think about it. And then finally, this is the coolest thing. Live it out. Read it, dream about it, live it out. And Jesus was all over this too. You remember when his disciples, they asked him in Luke, they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And then in the gospel writers, they give us what's called the Lord's Prayer, which should be our prayer because it's like the Lord telling us this is how we pray, like our prayer to the Lord, right? Anyway, the Our Prayer, Lord's Prayer. And if you're new here, we're gonna say this in a little bit, but if you've been here a while, you know this Lord's Prayer. And here's a line that you might pass up a lot, but it has to do with heaven today. It says this in Matthew 6:10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in what? Heaven. That's right. On earth as it is in heaven. What does that mean? It means a few things. First of all, that God's will isn't always done here on earth. There's some bad things that happen that you're like, God would not want that to be happening. And so Jesus says, hey, pray that his will is done here on earth just as it is in heaven. And the second thing it tells us is this, is that we can actually have heaven invade earth. We can have heaven come into our earthly experiences because he says, we want your will to be done here just like it is there. Bring heaven down, bring heaven down. Bring Jesus in is what we're asking when we pray that. So here's how this practically worked in my life this week. My wife, she's been doing lots of crafts lately. I'm loving to see what she's using God's creativity to do what she's doing. She gets home from Hobby Lobby. We spend about $3,000. No, I'm just joking. Like, oh! 4 different credit cards. No, she's a very frugal lady. And this is how frugal she is. I'll tell you how frugal she is. She comes home with a bag full of scrap leather. And as a son of a bookbinder, we had a bookbinder for 80 years in my family. You know, I'm working with buckram, leather, you name it. I love to smell it, this and that. First of all, I got excited and I thought, oh my goodness, they're making money off that. We could have been rich when I was in the 80s, right? I had all this extra. It's basically when they're making Bibles, they're cutting off the extras, throw it in there. Here's $14. 50% off though, Hobby Lobby. So she brings it, so excited, you know, and I'm smelling it, I'm looking at it, I'm loving it. I'm like, what's she gonna do with that, you know? So she has this Pinterest, Pinterest is where you get all these ideas, heavenly things. And so she gets this and she's, I'm gonna make these earrings. And I'm telling you guys, they are beautiful, beautiful earrings. And this is what I thought you're like, why is he telling us this? Here's heaven. When you are in a heavenly state, you are dwelling with the Lord, right? We've already established that. Dwelling with God, heaven. And we are also made, the Bible tells us, in his image. And we are supposed to reflect the image. We're supposed to reflect God to the world. And so I believe that when we dwell with him, and we say, heaven invade earth, God invade me, I want you to invade me. When we do that and we start to see God's image coming through and God's characteristics and the unique ways that he has gifted us, such as to be able to make beautiful leather earrings, and we walk into a room with those earrings, you are bringing heaven into that room. Think about that, make that connection. When you are doing your sweet spot, what God designed you to do, and you're reflecting his glory, whatever that is, you are bringing heaven into that office building. You are bringing heaven into that hospital. You are bringing heaven into that restaurant when you are doing what God has designed you to do. So praise be to God that we not only can see what heaven is going to be like, but he has allowed us, with Jesus dwelling in us, to let heaven live and come into every room that we come into. I encourage you guys, read about it. Dream about it and bring heaven as God does through you to wherever you go. Amen.